Well, it's great to have everyone here. Thank you for signing up and joining us for this webinar today. I hope that it's going to be a really useful thing. This topic of learning tunes was one that was chosen through the Jazz St. Louis Education Facebook group. If you're not a part of that group, then I would highly recommend it. We're going to post all of these webinars after they're recorded to that group. So if you want to access any of the information later, you can do that there. But definitely join the Jazz St. Louis Education Facebook group so that you can keep track of any webinar series, but also the other programs and activities that we have going on through our education department here at Jazz St. Louis. My name is Bennett Wood. I am the education coordinator here at Jazz St. Louis. A lot of the work that I do here at Jazz St. Louis relates to the outward-facing programs that we have. For example, our jazz residencies, where we have folks coming in and working with students in the public schools for a full week, and then they perform at the end of the week. I also help coordinate our Jazz for Our Schools program, where we are bringing students in to the club post-COVID, bringing folks into the club and letting them listen to music. So that's what I do. And I'm also going to talk to you a little bit today about learning tunes. So first, a little bit of housekeeping. If you signed up for this webinar, you are signed up for all four through the month of July. So you will get emails, you'll get reminders for those Thursday webinars series. And we'll keep try and keep you posted. Again, if you miss one, they'll be posted by the following Monday. So this coming Monday, this webinar will be uploaded to the Jazz STL Education Facebook group. So you can find that stuff there. I also need to mention some folks that are helping us out. For one, this series is in collaboration with the Wednesday night jazz jam at the Dark Room. That jam session is hosted by our friend Bob Dubu. And he actually made some suggestions too as far as some of the format for this webinar. So shout out to Bob and his help with everything. And then also a huge thanks to the folks in-house here at Jazz St. Louis who are making this series possible. So I mentioned Patrick, Gabe, and Colin. Also, Paul Heinrich, who works for our production team, he helped hook us up with microphones, and Andy Ament, who's not able to be here today. So if you have questions throughout the webinar today, you can put them in the chat at any time. My producer, Gabe, will be relaying those questions to me. Please be patient. If I'm in the middle of a thought, I may go ahead and finish the thought before addressing the question, or I may not get to the question until the end of the webinar. I will have reserved some time at the end for Q&A. So with all that housekeeping out of the way, let's go ahead and get into the purpose for what we're doing today. If you're studying jazz, if you're learning to play, one of the most crucial elements of your development is adding new repertoire. And we always want to be supplementing the tunes that we know with new tunes, new repertoire. And so the goal of this webinar is to maybe introduce you to some tunes that are a little bit outside of the standard call list that you might find at a jam session, but a tune that could very easily be adapted to almost any jazz jam session setting. So we're learning new tunes, and that's always a good thing. One of the other things we're gonna try and do here is try and understand the historical and cultural significance of the music that we're studying. So we're gonna learn about who wrote the song. We're gonna try and keep track of notable recordings and arrangements of the song. Excuse me for a minute. Can we go ahead and grab that phone? Whatever's dinging, something's dinging in the background. So we'll go ahead and get that silenced. Historical, cultural, social context. It's important to get that stuff and know where the music is coming from and what is notable about it. And then another thing that is important that I don't think we talk about enough as it relates to learning repertoire is building a sense of community. And as I mentioned, this webinar series is in collaboration with the Jazz Jam, the Wednesday night Jazz Jam at the Dark Room, and our friend Bob DeBoo. And so if you're in the St. Louis area, or if you're visiting the St. Louis area and you want to come to the Jazz Jam and, you know, learn this new tune this week and then play it on this coming Wednesday, you can do that. But even if you're outside the St. Louis area and you're learning new repertoire, find a community of musicians, form a band, or if you already have a band, then bring in new repertoire to perform with your group. Learning new repertoire is also about, you know, finding new common ground, right? So every time I learn a new tune, I'm looking for places to try out that new piece of repertoire and trying to find common experiences with other musicians. So building community. Two more points we're gonna get to. We're gonna implement some strategies to learn the tune, but also to retain the tune. If you've learned any repertoire in almost any musical genre, you've probably encountered the phenomenon of feeling like you really know it, and then you come back to it in a week or a month or 6 months or 3 years later, and you realize, I didn't really retain that. So we're gonna talk about some strategies for retaining the knowledge that you've learned. And then I'll also outline some next steps. So for if you feel like, okay, I've mastered this tune, what are some things that I can do beyond just learning the tune to kind of take my playing or my musicianship to the next level? So the tune that we're learning today, and I believe it was advertised in the Jazz STL Education Group as Veird Blues. This tune is really a 3-for-1 deal, though. The tune Veird Blues, which is you'll see it most commonly recorded under that title, was actually recorded under 3 different titles, as you'll see. This tune is most commonly associated with Miles Davis. There's a famous recording from 1956 on the record Collector's Items. And then Miles recorded the tune under a different title later the same year, that other title, Trane's Blues. And that was with Miles Davis' first great quintet on a record called Working with the Miles Davis Quintet. But those Miles recordings, those two recordings may have helped popularize the tune, they're actually preceded by a recording that appears on a Paul Chambers record. Paul Chambers, you know, wonderful bass player, played with a ton of noteworthy legendary musicians, Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Whitney Kelly, lots of folks. But Paul Chambers also recorded some music where he was the leader, of course. So in 1956, he recorded a record called Chambers Music, little play on words there, Chambers Music. The record was recorded, most of the record was recorded March 1st and 2nd, 1956. And then there are some bonus tracks that appear on later recordings that actually came from a later session. But we're gonna focus on those first two recording dates, March 1st and 2nd, 1956. This record includes, of course, Paul Chambers on bass and leading the session, Kenny Drew on piano, Philly Joe Jones on drums, and a young tenor saxophone player named John Coltrane. And there's a tune on the record called John Paul Jones. So this tune was brought in by Coltrane. And that name is interesting, John Paul Jones. John Paul Jones was a naval captain in the American Revolution. I don't think John Coltrane named the tune for that John Paul Jones. It's possible. Now, some of you in the audience might be raising your hand and going, oh, I know John Paul Jones. Led Zeppelin. Yeah, I know John Paul Jones. But that John Paul Jones was born in 1946, so he was only 10 years old. So it probably wasn't that John Paul Jones. So in my research on this, I'm kind of looking at, okay, what other connections could there be? There's a John Paul Jones Park in Bay Ridge in Brooklyn. And so it's likely that the tune, the title, is actually drawn from that connection. You know, Coltrane was living in New York at this time. And so probably he spent some time in that park. And that's where the title of the tune comes from. So let's give a listen to, we're going to listen to the complete audio from that Paul Chambers recording, John Paul Jones from 1956. Let's give that a listen. To John Coltrane, but that first chorus is killing. So I'm sorry to cut him off in the midst of that. But again, that's from Paul Chambers music, March 1st and 2nd, 1956. Now let's fast forward 14 days to March 15th, 1956. This is a tune called Veird Blues, and I think you'll notice it sounds a lot like John Paul Jones. Before we get into that one, let's also note the personnel on this recording. So Miles Davis is on this. This is a Miles Davis record. On tenor saxophone, we have Sonny Rollins. On piano, we have Tommy Flanagan. On bass, Paul Chambers, who's his album that the previous recording came from. And then on drums, Art Taylor. So let's give a listen to the melody on Veird Blues. Yeah, cool. So you note that it's the same melody. There are some very subtle differences where there, you know, there's some maybe little fragments of phrases that are left out. Some notable ones in the very end of the last phrase. They don't play that last gesture that appears in the John Paul Jones recording. So we've got March 1st and then March 15th, and then just a couple months later, May 11th, 1956. As a part of the series of sessions that Miles Davis recorded to fulfill the rest of his Prestige contract, he went into the studio with the first great quintet with John Coltrane, with Red Garland on piano, again Paul Chambers on bass, and Philly Joe Jones on drums. And this comes from working with the Miles Davis quintet. This one's called Trane's Blues, but as you might have guessed, it's the same melody. This recording's a little bit brighter. It's also got a shout section at the very end, which we'll get into if we have time. So let's listen to Trane's Blues. Blues. So they're all noteworthy recordings. Obviously, we're talking about jazz royalty when we're talking about Paul Chambers and Miles Davis and Sonny Rollins on the second recording there, and John Coltrane on the first and third recording. So all of these are great source material for you know, transcribing solos. There's, you know, killing solos on all three of these recordings. You know, when we're learning tunes, most of the time you're not going to be finding that, oh, there are three separate titles for the same tune. But in this instance, there are these three. So it's good to be aware of that. And again, you know, when I picked this tune to do for this webinar, I was aware of you know, two of the three titles. But as I'm digging through, okay, oh, John Paul Jones, which actually turns out to be the first instance of this song being recorded. So while Veird Blues a lot of times gets attributed to Miles Davis, I think it's safe to say that it's a John Coltrane composition. Again, it comes from that chambers music recording, and we know that John Paul Jones recording or the lead sheet was contributed by John Coltrane. So anytime I'm learning a tune, I'm going to start by finding recorded examples, and that's exactly what we've done today. We're trying to give a survey of recorded examples of the tune before we try and write it out or put it on the horn, just to get a sense of maybe what's the most standard version of the tune, or what's the original quote unquote version of the tune. And part of the reason that that's really important is because in jazz recordings, you know, you'll notice if you've learned any Tin Pan Alley standards, for example, that the melody can have a lot of variation within it from maybe from what was originally written for Broadway to the way that the melody is performed on the record. This is a jazz standard. So in this case, you know, what Coltrane brought into the studio on March 1st and 2nd of 1956 probably was written out, but he was the only horn on the session, so maybe not. From our perspective, though, learning the tune, we have to recognize that this music comes from an oral tradition. And somebody who's a lot smarter than I am, Allison Miller, said that, you know, in an oral tradition, that the written form of the language always comes last. So what that means to me, as I heard it, was that, you know, I gotta deal with the oral connection with the music before I start penciling it out. And so instead of going online and doing a Google search for Veird Blues lead sheet, I'm gonna first go and look on YouTube, look on Apple Music, whatever your preferred source is for listening, and I'm gonna find as many recordings as I can. We're not gonna listen to all these today, but I just wanna mention a couple of other notable recordings that you should be aware of. Steve Grossman Quintet, Steve Grossman, great saxophonist, from a record called I'm Confessin', featuring another great saxophonist, Harold Land. There's a Hampton Hawes recording of this song. There's a Phineas Newborn recording from a live jam session, I believe. In 1960, there's a Dave Pike. Dave Pike was a vibraphonist, a recording that actually features Bill Evans on piano. And then a more recent recording, Gary Smullyan, the great baritone saxophonist, did a live recording of this. So I would encourage you to seek those out. And as you listen, also listen for differences between the three examples that we checked out today and that we're going to be learning from today, and maybe compare those with some of those more recent recordings. So when I'm learning a new tune, I first like to start with the listening portion. And I will listen until I can sing along. So that might be a lot of passes of listening, depending upon how complicated the melody is. And this melody is not as simple as something like C-Jam Blues. You know, if we're learning, that you might be able to sing in maybe one pass, or maybe a couple of passes if you're new to this sort of thing, and that's fine. Be patient with yourself, take your time. This melody has a little bit more to it, but we're gonna try and break it down into manageable chunks. So we're gonna start with, before we put up anything up on the screen, let's just listen to the John Paul Jones recording. We're going to go all the way back to the very beginning, the first recorded example of this tune. And let's listen to just the first four measures of the tune. Cool. So we've got da 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 da. If we just deal with that part of the melody first. Now I know this melody already. So for me it starts on F, but if we're playing in concert key, it starts on E flat. I'm gonna kind of speed up the learning process for you a little bit and tell you that this tune is a B flat blues. So the starting pitch for this tune is really interesting because B flat blues, the first chord is going to be a B flat 7. So I'm just playing root and then a shell. I've got the 7 on the bottom of the third. And our melody starts right there. That's kind of crunchy. It doesn't seem like that should work. But part of the reason it is working is because that melody is very quickly moving away from that, right? And it's anticipating. So by the time we land on the first chord, we're actually on the 5 as opposed to starting on that. The first note of the melody is the 4th, though, in relation to the tonic. Okay. So that alone makes it noteworthy. And we can actually kind of come up with a description for this. It's a chromatic approach because the goal here is the 5th. E flat, E, F. And then the next part of the melody also has a chromatic approach. Chromatic approach to B flat. So chromatic approach to F. Chromatic approach to B flat. Chromatic approach to F to B flat. There's that C jam blues melody, if you're familiar with that tune. So if we really kind of get down to the most basic, if we strip away the ornamentation of these chromatic approach tones, it's really these two goal notes. And then we've got kind of a bluesy thing here. So in that home key of B flat, a flat third, or you could say sharp 9, up to the 4, and then back to 1. And then again, we'll get into the a little bit more of the kind of chord changes and how this works. Because actually, it's going to go to E flat, and so this E flat and D flat won't be rubbing up against the third on the B flat 7. They'll be actually happening over E flat 7. So we again the very first part of this. Okay, let's just deal with that part. So I've transcribed this. We've kind of listened to it. Now let's look at it. Gabe, if you can throw that example up on the screen. Yeah. Yep. All right. So we're looking at it right there. And we've got all the stuff we talked about, starting on the 4th, E flat, E, F, and then that repeated phrase. So I'm gonna play this first four measures. And here's where it gets a little interesting. Right. So, again, that's really, I guess it's in my key, E flat pentatonic. So D flat pentatonic, if you're in concert key. So it's got kind of a hard bop bluesy kind of feel to it, that line. And then at the very end of the fourth bar, you see the last three notes. Those are really a pickup into the next phrase. And again, we have those chromatic approach tones, a chromatic approach tone going to concert B flat. And then let's go ahead and let's jump over to bars 5 through 8. Let's give a listen to this as well. Back to the original phrase. Yeah, so really, it's just a couple of chromatic approach tones happening a fourth away that form the main part of the idea here for the first 8 bars. This is actually, it's got a lot in common with blues poetry. And if you think about like the origin of the blues, as jazz musicians, a lot of times when we talk about blues, we're talking about a 12-bar blues harmonic form. I think it's useful to think about, okay, where does that harmonic form come from? Is it always 12 bars long? And if we look earlier in the music, if we even look, you know, pre-jazz, that form, the harmonic form, actually comes from blues poetry. So think about a kind of standard blues lyric like "Rock me, baby, rock me all night long," and then that phrase is repeated: "Rock me, baby, rock me all night long," with a different harmonic underpinning. So there's some similarity here in this melody. So that's like the initial statement. That's the "rock me, baby, rock me all night long." Now, the next phrase, bars 5 through 8, let's pop those up on the screen again. This is like the second phrase, the repeat of that phrase, but again, different harmonic underpinning, and you can see the chord changes there on the screen. So we're going to the 4 chord, back to 1, and then ultimately it's going to lead us into the turnaround. And then my favorite part of a blues poem or of the 12-bar form is the turnaround. Or the punchline, however you want to think about it. If we're talking about blues poetry, then it's "rock me, baby, rock me all night long," a repeat of that, "rock me, baby, rock me all night long." And then the punchline is "rock me, baby, like my back ain't got no bone." So that's bars 9 through 12. Let's see what that looks like in the context of John Paul Jones. Again, sorry for the examples, got the pickups kind of cut off from the previous, but. So there's a lot of bluesy elements in there. And again, it's the melody's drawing on, if you're looking at this, you might be thinking, okay, I see some things that look like that maybe look like blues scale. And so, yeah, there's definitely some of those elements in there. Also, you know, if you're looking at the chord changes, there are a lot of chromatic approaches to notes or surround figures that kind of add to some of the dissonance within this melody that make it appealing and interesting to listen to. So let's put the whole melody up on the screen and let's give a listen again to John Paul Jones, the melody in its entirety. You may notice in the written melody here some slight variations from exactly what Coltrane plays on this record, and I'm gonna attribute that to the fact that I'm kind of drawing from all three examples, And there are some slight differences in the way that the melody is played. I alluded to this earlier, but that entire last phrase in measure 12 is omitted in the Veird Blues recording of the tune. So there are some variations. Okay, so that's the melody to the tune. Now the harmony, if you are, we can leave that example up while I talk about it. The harmony for the tune, again, it's a 12-bar blues form in the key of B flat. So if that's a new form, that's fine. You know, as we're starting out, a lot of times 12-bar blues is a great starting place for learning to improvise. So if you're just starting to improvise, starting to learn new tunes, great. Welcome in. The water's warm. A good starting place for improvising, you know, might be to implement some blanket scales over this. And if you're not familiar with that term, blanket scale, think of it like, I don't want to deal with all of these chord changes, so I'm going to throw a blanket over all of them. And so instead of acknowledging B flat 7, E flat 7, back to B flat 7, and especially we get into these kind of hairier changes where there's a little bit more harmonic movement in bars 8 and 9, I could just use one scale to navigate the changes. So there are a couple different blanket scales that you could use. A very common one, of course, would be the blues scale. So that's one that we hear a lot. It's a common one in jazz education for sure. There are some other options that might work as well, or maybe even better. So one of the ones that I like to use, if you're familiar with the pentatonic scale, again, you can think of your major scale, omit the fourth and the seventh scale degree. So in this key, I'm playing in C. That's 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. So for me, that's C, D, E, G, and A. On piano, you're playing B flat, C, D, F, and G. On alto saxophone, you're playing G, A, B, D, and E. So it sounds like this. Okay, so that gives us a starting place if we add in the flat 3. So, or actually I'm going to say, instead of adding in, let's substitute for the major third, let's substitute the minor third. So it sounds like this. So that's a blanket scale that you could use where, okay, I'm not gonna acknowledge every change. And that allows you to really think more about the way that you're phrasing your melodies and think about connecting rhythmically. I'm imagining that most of our listeners and participants today are digging a little deeper. So, you know, still some basic ways of addressing the harmony here would be to first address each chord vertically. You could, for example, outline each chord 1, 3, 5, 7 from the bottom. Right. So that is one way of getting through there, and we could reverse that, or you could where you could go 7, 5, 3, 1. That would be a way of getting around those changes where you're not starting on the root. Or you could practice alternating. So that would be like a vertical approach. Especially for horn players, I think that's really useful. Maybe if you're a piano player, you're voicing the chord every time that you comp the changes. So, there's still benefit from that vertical approach. Another approach that you can take, and I'll switch over to the piano here. We can take the take the lead sheet down. But another approach is to think a little bit more along the lines of the kind of linear approach, or thinking about the way that the chords change. And I'm thinking specifically of 7-3 and 3-7 resolutions. So if you're a horn player and you're listening and you don't play any piano, you should start today. You know, get some sort of basic piano book so you can at least find the notes on the keyboard, so you can find middle C and kind of find your way around the keyboard. And then the next step, the next thing I would do as I'm trying to learn to play jazz, would be to learn to find thirds and sevens on the keyboard. So we've got a B flat seven. I'm going to play B flat in the root, third and seven in my right hand. So third is D, seven is A flat. Now the next chord we're going to E flat. So I'm going to change to that root in the left hand, and I'm going to go to G and D flat. But instead of moving the whole voicing up here, I'm just going to shift everything down a half step, and I get those two notes. So again, back to our B flat seven, and then watch my right hand just shifts down. So if, you know, as a horn player, I can only play one note at a time. I can't play those three notes at the same time. But I can still trace the harmonic movement of the tune by following those leading tones. Now I'm to the approaching the turnaround. So I'm really just trying to follow as naturally as I can those 3-7 resolutions, and you can find your way through the tune pretty easily that way. I say pretty easily, but it takes a little bit of work to figure out how these would move. So we go to E flat 7, back to B flat 7. I'm going to skip to G7, and then we're going to go to the turnaround 2-5. So C7, you've got the 7 on the bottom, B flat, E flat, and then here's the magic, 2-5. So again, 7-3 resolution, back to 1. So you can see how these voicings move, really just move in half steps until we get to G7. So if that's too basic for you, then another way that you can go about practicing, you might be, if you're already transcribing, then you probably played a lot of 12-bar blues. So then maybe you're using this as a vehicle to practice your 2-5 licks. You know, there's a lot of different ways that we could dig into the harmony of 12-bar blues to kind of get a little bit deeper. But again, blues form, one of the most common forms, everybody has to deal with it as you're developing your repertoire, as you're developing your sound as a jazz improviser. So hopefully those are some ways that you can try and dig a little deeper into that harmony if you haven't already done that. Let's talk about some next steps. I want to leave a little bit of time at the end for questions if we have them. One of the things that always strikes me about learning a tune, a lot of times I learn the melody and then I learn the changes and I'm like, okay, I'm ready to go to the jam session. But I've skipped a step, which is the ending. So we've got to think about the end of the tune too. I think it would be a good idea, and to maybe hear, let's take a listen to a couple of these examples here. Let's listen to the end of the John Paul Jones recording. Let's check out how Coltrane ended the tune. Thank you.
right, so he just tags that last phrase, and then they end on a B flat 7 with some alteration. Let's check out one more ending. Do I have the ending on Veird Blues? Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's listen to two more endings then. Let's check out how does Miles end it on Veird Blues. Example, and I'll give you a heads up, this one's just a little different. So this is from Trane's Blues, the final of those three recordings we focused on. Got a tag ending at the very end. The last example, again, it's titled Trane's Blues on Working with the Miles Davis Quintet. They added a shout chorus. So definitely learn the, you know, to and get comfortable playing that tag. You know, regardless of your instrument, Paul Chambers did a really cool thing on that first recording we listened to. He played this kind of ascending bass line at the end. Which that's like kind of a nice touch if you're a bass player to check that out. If you're a horn player, you know, maybe practice that tag because that can be a little bit tricky to do for the first time on stage in front of an audience. So, you know, do that when you practice the tune, as you practice the melody, also practice ending it. You know, piano players, guitar players, practice your dominant 7 sharp 11 voicing. I think that's what they go to on the John Paul Jones recording. It sounds great. There's some options for ending the tune, but you know, again, a next step beyond just learning the melody to play over the changes, learning to end the tune, would be maybe to go back and grab that shout chorus from Working with the Miles Davis Quintet as a, you know, kind of a next step. When I'm learning new tunes, I frequently find myself coming back a week or 2 weeks or several months later and feeling like I'm not remembering it as well as I was. So one of the most crucial elements for retention of new tunes is just revisiting frequently over a long period. Even if you revisit a tune for a couple, you know, 5-6 minutes once every day for a month, that's probably going to help that tune stick in your brain a little better than if it's a tune that you spend 8 hours on for one day and then don't touch for another 6 months. So I would just encourage you, as you learn this tune, as you become more comfortable with it, to revisit the tune regularly. Another tool that I use, I have an Excel spreadsheet. This is where I push up my nerd glasses. And I've got all the tunes that I've learned and the key that I learned it in. And the starting pitch, so this one starts on the fourth relative to the key of B flat. It's starting on an E flat. And I also include when I learned the tune and when's the last time that I played or practiced or performed the tune. And I will occasionally just randomize that list and see what pops up. And that's a good way to kind of refresh. Another thing that you can do, if you know you use a reminders function on your phone, you know, maybe you learn a new tune and okay, I want to make sure that I give myself a reminder to come back to this. So I'll set a reminder that's, you know, 1 week and then a month and then 6 months from when I initially learned the tune to just remind myself to go back and revisit it. And then the final way that I feel like I retain information better is through performance. So again, the jam session is a great place to go and not only show off what you've learned, but help that information stick. And also sometimes when you get on stage and you're performing in front of people, that's where you realize, oh, okay, I thought I had this in a practice room, but when I'm on stage in front of people, it's not as solid as I thought it was. And so if that happens, then take that as a clue that, okay, I need to go back and revisit this tune a little bit more frequently. Some next steps, some things that you could think of beyond, you know, what we've talked about today. I mentioned learning the shout section. It's not essential to being able to perform the tune, but it might be a cool thing. If you have your own band and you want to add this tune to your repertoire, add that shout section in. Another thing, if you have your own band or if you have a group of musicians that you play regularly with, write your own arrangement of this tune. Whether that's for, you know, a quintet arrangement with, you know, specific rhythms or a big band arrangement. It could be any size group, but write an arrangement of the tune for the size ensemble that you like to perform with. And then a last option might be, you know, this was a blues. I think about this a lot, actually, that this is a blues that John Coltrane wrote for his friend Paul Chambers' session, and he brought the tune into play. So I look at that and I think, well, I should learn John Coltrane's tunes, but I also should follow that example and write some of my own tunes. So this is a nudge to everybody out there listening to write your own blues. You know, and you can borrow things from this melody. You could borrow ideas from other melodies that you've heard that are 12-bar blues, or it doesn't even have to be a blues. But find a melodic shape that you like and write a blues melody with that. So this kind of wraps up what I want to talk about today, but I am eager to hear from you out there in the interwebs. Do you have specific questions about this tune? Are there other questions you have about 12-bar blues? We've got three more of these sessions coming up. Are there specific questions or concerns that you want us to address through those next three webinars? Are there specific tunes that maybe you think should be played at jam sessions, but just don't seem to get called very much that we should include in this webinar series so that the next time you show up to that jam session, other people will know the tune as well. So I'll stall for time for a couple more minutes and see if we get any questions from those of you who are out there. Again, the Jazz STL Education webpage is, Facebook group. It's also a webpage, but it's a Facebook group. If you join the Jazz STL Education Facebook group, you can get updates on this webinar series. There will be an announcement about the tune that we'll be learning next week. And you can also find a lot of great content about what we have going on here at Jazz St. Louis in the education realm. Also, I want to remind folks that this webinar series is in collaboration with Bob DeBoo and the Wednesday Night Jazz Jam at the Dark Room. So I plan to be there next Wednesday. I plan to call this tune. If you want to join me and play this tune, that would be super fun. I always enjoy learning new material and playing it with people in person. So definitely plan to join us on Wednesday night if you're in the area. And if not, find some other musicians and learn this tune and play it, perform it. It's a great melody.
All right, we're gonna go ahead and jump into week two of our webinar.
Yeah.
Where's that coming from?
I got it.
We got a little bit of a sound loop going on here. We're gonna take care of that. Sorry to leave everybody hanging. Okay, so first I'll introduce myself. My name is Bennett Wood. I'm the education coordinator here at Jazz St. Louis. I mostly work with programming residencies, with all of our outward facing school programs. So the Jazz for Our Schools program and other things as needed around the education area here at Jazz St. Louis. This webinar series was put together in conjunction with the Jazz St. Louis Education Facebook group. The topic for the webinar series, Learning Tunes, was selected by a vote of the people. So if you're one of the people that voted, thank you for that, and thanks for joining us. If this is not a topic that you chose, then sorry, we'll try to do better next time. But also, bring your friends along. Have them encourage them to join the group and to participate in those polls going forward. And hopefully we can get a topic that's interesting, like the one that we're going to get into today. So as I like to do every time, I want to first mention that this webinar series is a collaboration with the Wednesday Night Jazz Jam at the Dark Room here in St. Louis. Shout out to the Kranzberg Foundation and all of their support of the arts. That partnership is made possible partly through Bob DeBoo, who runs the Wednesday Night Jazz Jam. Although if you were there last night, it was Bernard Terry who was holding it down while Bob DeBoo was out. So part of the mission of this webinar series is to introduce some repertoire that works well in a jazz jam setting, but maybe some things that are a little bit off the beaten path in terms of they don't get as regularly called at jazz jam sessions, and in particular at our jam session here in St. Louis. So if you're tuning in from New York, you might say, ah, that tune gets called here all the time. Okay, well, but here we're trying to kind of expand our repertoire for the jazz jam just a little bit. That again, thanks to Bob DeBoo, thanks to the folks at the Dark Room for putting on the Jazz Jam every week, and also for collaborating with us on this. We learn a new tune each week, and then if you come to the Jazz Jam, you can play that tune the following Wednesday. So, for example, this coming Wednesday, we will play this tune that I'm going to go ahead and share with you. Now we're gonna learn today a Dizzy Gillespie composition titled Woody and You, also titled Algo Bueno. I know last week we got into a blues that had three different titles, and my colleague here, Gabe, asked if that was a theme. Not an intentional theme, but a little bit. So some thank yous to, first of all, my colleagues here at Jazz St. Louis, Andy Ament and Gabe Miller in the education department. Also, Paul, I got to pronounce it right, Paul Henrich, I think I got that, and Patrick Skinner in production here at Jazz St. Louis. They do a wonderful job hooking us up with microphones and running all the sound through this webinar series. If you have any questions during the webinar today, feel free to pop those into the chat. It may take me just a minute to get to your question, but yeah, please feel free to pop it into the chat at any point, and I will address it either during the webinar or during the Q&A section at the very end. Okay, so learning new tunes. Again, I want to talk just briefly about some of our learning objectives for today. We're learning new repertoire, and specifically repertoire that's aimed at being used in a jazz jam type setting. So we're going to stay away from tunes that have hyper ornate arrangements that are part of the tune, and really kind of focus more on things that are easily adapted to that jazz jam setting. We're going to talk briefly about some of the historical and cultural context of the tune, including listening to some of the important historical recordings of the tune, and talk about why those are notable. And then also, you know, this collaboration with the Dark Room is really special because it provides an opportunity to not only learn the repertoire, but then come together with a community of like-minded jazz musicians and play that communally. So a lot of times we're learning tunes, you know, you may be in the practice room learning a tune, and it may only be for your own edification, but this has that benefit, but also the opportunity to come together with other folks and make music together. Lastly, we're going to talk about some ways to implement, some strategies to implement to retain the tunes that you're learning, and then also point the way forward for some next steps that you can take. So if, as we're going through the discussion of Woody and You today, if you feel like, this is too basic for me, hang in there, because I'll have some things that you could do if you want to, you know, kind of take it a little further, get a little spicier with what you do on the tune. So as I mentioned, we're talking Dizzy Gillespie, we're talking Woody and You, aka Algo Bueno, which translates to something good. Algo Bueno, something good. Unlike last week, where we had a little bit of controversy over Veird Blues, which is a lot of times attributed to Miles Davis, but is actually a John Coltrane composition, this one is very clearly a Dizzy Gillespie composition. We know that partly because it was a commissioned tune. So Woody Herman paid Dizzy Gillespie to write three tunes for him, and Woody and You was one of those three tunes that was composed in 1943. The first recording of the tune comes in 1944, and it's a famous recording by the great tenor saxophonist Coleman Hawkins. The first time and I should mention also, Dizzy Gillespie was on that first recording. He's likely the individual who brought the tune to Coleman Hawkins to record. Woody Herman didn't record the tune until much later, even though he commissioned the tune from Dizzy Gillespie. Dizzy Gillespie records the tune under his own name in 1947. It's a great arrangement of the tune by an arranger named Gil Fuller. And in particular, we're going to pay attention to that arrangement's got some real nuggets in it. There's a shout section at the end of that arrangement that becomes kind of a fixture within some of the recordings of the tune in 1956 and going forward from there. So we're going to listen to three examples of this tune to start off, and then we'll maybe listen to a fourth example if we have some extra time. Let's start with that 1947 recording from Dizzy Gillespie. It wasn't released until 1949. You're going to hear Dizzy on here. You're also going to hear Chano Pozo, who's a great conga player, famous Cuban conga player. And this is only about a year before he was killed. He was killed in a tragic incident in New York City, but a really important figure in the music and important to that Cuban jazz intersectionality in the music. So let's listen to Dizzy Gillespie. Here we go. This is Algo Bueno. Thank you. heard a little bit of Dizzy Gillespie on that. Sorry to cut that short, but part of what we're listening for here is just kind of the arrangement, again, very cool arrangement by Gil Fuller, but you're going to hear that the melody is quite a lot different in his arrangement than some of the way that the melody's been popularized in smaller group performances. So let's listen, before we move on to the next recording, let's listen to this shout chorus that's kind of the outro for, or not an outro, but an interlude going into the melody going out of the tune on the 1947 recording. Let's listen to that. Of course, it's a Dizzy Gillespie recording, so we've got to have screaming high trumpets and all the cool elements of that arrangement. I love that arrangement. As I mentioned, the way this melody is popularized sounds quite a bit different. And Dizzy Gillespie actually re-recorded the tune on an album called Have Trumpet Will Excite, great album title, in 1959. And we're going to hear when we get to that recording. Really, kind of the way, if this tune is called at a jam session, the way that most people are hearing the melody in their head, something like this. Section. In the Gil Fuller arrangement, that's quite a lot more legato in the way that it's phrased. I want to go now to a 1957 recording from Sonny Rollins. This is from a great record, Live at the Village Vanguard, one of my favorite Sonny Rollins records. And this one we're listening to partly for the way that he plays the melody, which is quite a lot different from the other examples we're listening to, but primarily because Sonny just plays so great on this record, and it's one where if you're gonna listen to this tune and learn it and perform it, it's a recording you have to be aware of. So here's Sonny Rollins in 1957, Live at the Village Vanguard.
Thank you.
there's that track is, I think, somewhere around 9 minutes long, and it's just chock full of beautiful bop vocabulary. And if you're listening to this tune, and you're already kind of listening for the harmony of it, one of the reasons that I specifically chose this tune is that it has a lot of minor 2-5-1s in it. Or I should say minor 2-5s. It doesn't go to the one, but it's got that minor 2-5 harmony in there. And so, you know, when I listen to Sonny play over that, there's all this great vocabulary where he's navigating those minor 2-5s in an interesting way. Okay, lastly, we're going to listen to 1959, Dizzy Gillespie's Have Trumpet Will Excite. Junior Mance on piano, Lex Humphreys on drums, Sam Jones on bass, Les Spahn on guitar, Carlos Valdez on conga. Let's check this out. Half Trumpet Will Excite. Heard enough of that melody now to begin to understand what it sounds like. You'll notice we're starting with listening. I'm not pulling up a lead sheet. We're not looking at any written music first, you know, and I think this is an important thing to keep in mind about learning jazz standards, is that, again, it's an oral art form. So when you set out to learn something new, start with your ears. Start by searching out, okay, what are the essential recordings that I need to know in order to be able to play this tune? Who are some of the musicians that I should be listening to? Or who are the musicians? In my case, I'm thinking, if I type in Woody and You to learn the tune in Spotify or Apple Music, and Sonny Rollins' name comes up, and I've never heard that recording before, I'm definitely going to go check that one out because he's one of my favorite musicians. So I want to encourage you to think about that part of the process, whether it's learning this tune or any other tune that you might decide to learn. Always start with seeking out recordings before you go looking for a lead sheet. I understand there are sometimes those instances where I got a gig and I just found out, you know, 5 minutes before that we're going to be playing a tune that I don't know, and then you maybe have to use the lead sheet. But for tunes that you're going to call at a jam session, for tunes that you're adding to your repertoire, always start that learning process. I encourage you to start the learning process by listening first, even if you're going to go to a lead sheet after that to learn. Because among other things, you may find that there are differences between the definitive recordings and what's on the lead sheet, or what shows up in iReal Pro. So being aware of that and starting with your ear is always a good way to go. So this melody, I want to point out right away that Dizzy Gillespie, the last recording that we listened to, we hear this. And that's Dizzy playing the first part of that, and then the guitar answering, so then trumpet and then guitar. So that kind of back and forth, almost like a call and response kind of thing, is common through a lot of recordings of this tune. It's in that very first 1947 recording, but again, the way that the melody is played is very legato, so it sounds a little bit different. I want to bring up that second part of the line. This is how Sonny plays it. on the Village Vanguard. He plays. So that's not the first part of the melody. We're not hearing that. We're not hearing that. So, you know, you might ask yourself, well, okay, is that a different melody? Is he playing the melody wrong? I think the answer actually comes from a recording back in 1956, a recording that Sonny actually played on, an album called Max Roach Plus Four, and Sonny's playing that line, that counter line. And so when he came to play the tune at the Village Vanguard in 1957, he said, yeah, I'm gonna play that as the melody. So you'll hear it both ways, actually. I know that there's a John Scofield, I don't know if it's a recording, but it's a YouTube video of a live performance where he's playing this tune, and he plays the same line that Sonny plays. So I think either thing is acceptable, or if you've got more than one horn player or you know another instrument that can play that counter line, then it's nice to have both. So a good idea to learn both of those lines. All right, now let's actually look at this melody. We're gonna start out just broadly talking about the form. It's a 32 bar AABA form. So 32 measures long, 8 bar A sections, 8 bar bridge. We're gonna start with the A sections, and I'm gonna have Andy pull up a graphic on the screen here so you can see those first 8 bars. And you might be looking at this going, oh man, that's a lot of stuff there. G minor 7 flat 5, and then C7, we got flat 13, sharp 9. It's a lot of information. So this is the minor 2-5 that I alluded to earlier. If you're familiar with 2-5-1s, minor 2-5s act a little bit different, and the way that we approach them is a little bit different from the way that that you do with a major 2-5-1. So we'll dig into that part of it a little bit later, but let's just start by again, now that you can see it on the screen, that A section melody. And I've only got the kind of what I consider the main melody on here, but I'll play the answering phrase too. Now with the answering phrase. That's the A section melody, and it just, you know, pretty much like we've got harmonically, we've got these minor 2-5s moving down by whole step. The melody pretty much follows that until the very end. Let's move on to the bridge, and we'll just kind of go quickly through and talk briefly about. Again, this is not crazy complicated. The key is weird. You know, we got a lot of flats in this key signature. And so that can be challenging, but you know, just looking purely at what's going on melodically. That's a little bit hairy. And then the whole line moves up a whole step. Okay, so But these are things I would encourage you, again, rather than go to the real book to learn the melody, maybe go listen to that 1959 recording of Dizzy Gillespie playing this melody. Again, Have Trumpet Will Excite is the name of that record. Find it on, you can look it up on YouTube, or we can link to it actually on YouTube. And you can slow it down, you know, slow it down to 50% if you need, slow it down to 25% if you need, and learn those melody lines. Now, finally, you know, in learning a tune, I always want to, as we kind of wrap up the melody, I always want to think about how I'm going to end the tune as well. And so well, let's listen to, we're gonna skip the, we listened to those three examples, but I will tell you, if you go and listen to the ending on each of those tunes, it's pretty ornate, and not something that you're likely to pull off unless everybody happens to have learned the ending from the same recording. So I think a better listening example for a way to end this in a jam session setting actually comes from Max Roach. This is, again, the recording I alluded to that Sonny Rollins plays on from 1956. Can we pull up that one, Andy? In that example, they play that final line and then they just lay out on a. The final chord that's the last chord of the A section, there's a D flat major 7, and they're playing it with a sharp 11 in the lead voice. I'll have Andy throw up the full lead sheet here. Yeah, so that's what the whole form of the tune looks like. Again, A, B, in this case, C is our last A section there. But that's the entire form of the tune. Okay, so we've got these minor 2-5s. How do we deal with those? That can be a pretty, you know, kind of daunting task when you're starting out, especially if, as an improviser, you're primarily used to playing kind of blanket scales. And really, before we get into minor 2-5s, maybe we should talk at least briefly about how to approach major 2-5-1s. Of course, you can practice your 2-5s, practice chord outlines, 1-3-5-7. That's a great way to do it. You know, last week we talked about 7-3 resolutions. If you haven't watched that webinar, maybe go back and check that out. Those same rules still apply. So if I follow the 7 on the 2 chord, resolves down to the 3rd of the 5 chord. And you could take those 7-3 resolutions, you could practice playing those all the way through this form. And that would be a great ear training exercise to help yourself hear your way through the form. But another way that we commonly try and understand harmony as it relates to 2-5-1s is the chord scale approach. So let's look first at just a major 2-5-1, and 2-5. We're not getting to the 1. We're just dealing with the 2-5. So in the treble, in the bass clef, these are not what I would advocate as piano voicings at all. I just, for illustrative purposes, stacked up the chord in thirds. So you've got a D minor 7 there stacked up in the bass clef. And so you can see that the chord scale, that the sort of prescribed chord scale that we would use would be a D Dorian scale, which relates back to C major. We're doing this in C just because I think it's kind of easier to see where the... where the accidentals are, where the changes are taking place by starting in C. So D Dorian and then G Mixolydian over the 5 chord. So all of that is derived from a C major scale. So there's not a lot of mystery there. Now, that will work for the bridge, for example. We've got 2-5-1 in G flat. So I can take the respective Dorian and Mixolydian scales based in the key of G flat, and then the second half of the bridge, it moves up to A flat. So if I know my G flat major scale, if I know my A flat major scale, I'm cool on the bridge. I can make the changes, so to speak, on the bridge. But the A sections are a little trickier. So there are really three basic strategies that we could use for minor 2-5s. And the one that I think is maybe most commonly thought of is actually we're gonna skip. We'll get to diminished in a second. One of the most common ones that we see is relying on a harmonic minor scale in kind of a blanket fashion. And I'm gonna stare at my monitor here for a second. So we've got like a D. Oh wait, I think you gave me the wrong thing here, Andy. Give me see if you can give me the harmonic minor one.
Technical
difficulties. Sit tight. Hey, there we go. Okay, harmonic minor. So if this is really an easy transition when you think of it from the way that we deal with major two fives, because now we're taking a minor scale and applying it over all of the harmony, over the two and the five. But there are some limitations to this. So I'm going to switch over to the keyboard here and just kind of talk about these briefly. So here's our 2-5-1, and I guess I'll just do, we're going to do root shell voicing. So here's the bass note, and then I'm just doing the third and the seven and the flat five. Okay. But the scale that we're using is this one. Okay, so already one of the problems with using that as it's not necessarily a problem, but it's a potential for some dissonance, some unwanted dissonance, is this E flat, which is not going to jive very well. Not going to jive very well within that D half diminished. So that would be a note that we'd have to kind of avoid over that chord. Unless you want to just think of, you can simply ignore the two and think of everything kind of as a five chord. That's called portability of the dominant. It's a, again, jazz nerd term. But basically we're saying, okay, I know there's a two chord there, but I'm really just going to focus on the five chord. And this is a legitimate way to get through that harmonic, or get through the minor 2-5. Another approach that you can take is to, again, kind of a blanket scale approach, just use the diminished scale. That's got some notes that work better over the minor 2-5. And yeah, here Andy's pulled up. These are the same scale. For illustrative purposes, we're showing you them starting in different places, but it's the exact same, diminished scale. So you notice that it's got that E natural in there, so that'll work still very well over the half diminished chord. That works fine. So those again are what I would consider blanket type approaches to the minor 2-5. Now, if we really want to quote unquote nail the changes, if we want to very clearly outline all the minutiae of the harmony, you have to kind of use a different scale for the 2 than you would for the 5. And so this is where the melodic minor scale comes into play. Let's look at that one real quickly. All right, so if you know your major scales, the melodic minor scale is not that far off. So if you think of let's see, the one you see on the screen there, the first one you see is the F melodic minor, but we're starting on D. So let's just look at the F melodic minor first. F, G, A flat, B flat, C, D. Now that's really just an F major scale, but we've flatted the third. So instead of, we've got, okay. Now again, to make the mode fit, we're starting on the D, right? But if you know your major scale and you can flat the third, then you've got the melodic minor. So it's just kind of knowing which melodic minor to put where. That F melodic minor works great over the half diminished, the D half diminished. And then here's where things can really get colorful and interesting, using an A flat melodic minor over the G7. Yes, A flat melodic minor, which is a half step. We're starting a half step away from the root, but that A flat is already in the voicing of the dominant seven in a minor key like this. So all that nice, juicy, colorful stuff works really well over that five chord in the minor key. So let's hear from the folks in the room. Are you totally lost yet? Are there things, do you have questions about any of that stuff? Because that's a lot of information. Yeah, Gabe's gonna ask a question, yes.
I think I got slightly lost on the last bit when you were picking what scales, you were like, okay, this is the F.
Yeah, can we pull that graphic back up? So Gabe was just asking about those last two examples, which, sorry, I'm going kind of quick through these. We can use these melodic minor scales. If you think of this on the D half diminished, if you think I'm playing a melodic minor starting on the third, so I'm just stacking up the chord from the root 1, 3, 5, 7. Here's the third, and then I'm playing a melodic minor scale from there. Down to D, now I'm starting on the root. So all of the notes in that scale will work over that half diminished. And then for the next chord, for G7, there are a couple different names for this scale. So sometimes you'll hear the altered scale is a term that gets thrown around. I like thinking of it as the melodic minor scale starting a half step up from the root. Like, here's our root G, and we're starting here. A lot of dissonance in there. So yeah, it's two scales, a minor third apart. And that's one of the reasons, again, the first two examples, the blanketing examples, are probably a lot more approachable. And I definitely feel like I still go back to those blanketing type ideas where I'm playing either diminished ideas or ideas that are selectively using notes from the harmonic minor scale in the key. So in our example here, I'm playing just a minor 2-5 in the key of C, right? If we go all the way to 1, we'd be going to C minor. So in that example, I'd be blanketing the C minor, C harmonic minor, over the 2 and the 5. Any other questions from the gallery? Kai, you don't have a question? You just wanted to jump on and tell us what you played last night? Okay, that's all right. So, Without a question, I want to actually jump into, I think it's useful to talk about this theory and to talk about chord scale relationships I think it's useful to helping understand, but I think the most direct way to deal with playing minor two fives is actually to go to the recording. So again, you know, in the same way that if I'm trying to learn a new tune, I'm going to start by finding those core examples, those essential examples of the tune, and then maybe look for a lead sheet after I've listened to the tune a lot. If I'm trying to figure out how to play over minor two fives, I'm probably going to start with listening to great 2-5 vocabulary. So I have one that I've transcribed here. This is from it's from that Dizzy Gillespie recording on the album Have Trumpet Will Excite, but it's not Dizzy Gillespie. It's actually from the piano solo. It's from Junior Mance on this recording of Woody and You. Let's go ahead and give this a listen. We'll listen to the first chorus of Junior Mance's solo, and then I'll point out the lick that we're gonna look at. Okay, cool. Right there. Let's listen to that one more time. And I'll point out when that. Right here. All right. So we're not going to deal with that whole lick. We're just going to kind of grab the first half of it. But I think it's a great example of how to navigate these minor two fives. So let's go ahead and pull up that example. And you'll have to forgive my very clumsy piano playing, but start for the double flats. That's just the key we're in. So a lot of really cool bebop surround type stuff and chromatic approaches in this lick. I love this lick. Very cool. Yeah, so let's just kind of break this lick down real quickly. He starts with just an outline of the half diminished two. So that's just 7 flat 5 3 1, and then moving down chromatically. So it resolves to the 3 of the A flat 7. So 7-5-3-1 chromatic landing on the 3. So there's that 7-3 resolution. We hear it right there in the line. So anytime you have a line like that where the 7-3 resolution happens over the bar line, it's going to be a really clear way of establishing the harmony. And then he goes, this is a really cool kind of bopism. We hear this a lot in Charlie Parker's playing. 3 up 2 flat 9. So a chromatic surround back to 1. And then a half step approach. Again, 7-3. That G flat is the 7 of the A flat 7. And it's resolving to F natural, which is 3 of D flat major 7. So if you know, just look at the bar lines, we can see a 7-3 resolution, D flat going to C, and then in the next bar, G flat going to F natural. So it's a beautiful job of outlining the harmony, and it's one that's got a lot of cool bebop kind of ornamentation in there as well. So because of the way this harmony moves, this would be a lick that would be very conducive to, you know, transposing to these three minor keys and practicing all the way through. And then you'd be loaded for bear, so to speak. You'd be really well prepared for a minor 2-5, especially if you took this through every key. All right, so we've talked at length about Woody and You. There are, in terms of kind of next steps you could take, and again, minor two fives are a lot.
there are some options. Let's listen one more moment to Junior Mance. And in particular, we'll listen to the bridge. You hear these repeated 2/5s on the bridge. And in the second bar of the bridge, he actually takes the second 2/5 up a half step. So that might be an option that you'd want to explore if playing on this tune feels easy to you and you want to give yourself an extra challenge. I think that's one that that we hear, you know, these kind of things. So he plays something like that, which you hear in Fats Waller's Honeysuckle Rose. That's another example of that kind of thing. All right. Any questions? Any other questions, comments, thoughts? I think we're going to go ahead and get started here. Welcome everybody to week 3 of the Jazz St. Louis Education, what are we calling this? Learning Tunes? We're calling this Learning Tunes webinar. So throughout the month of July, we're learning a new tune every week. This is, again, installment 3. If you haven't been to the jam session yet, and you don't know how all of this works, I'll explain very briefly. We're doing this this webinar in collaboration with Bob DeBoo and the folks at the Dark Room with the Wednesday night Dark Room jam session. The tune that we cover in the webinar today, you can spend a week learning and then show up to the Wednesday night jam session. I believe that date is, I have it in my notes, July 27th. So that's next Wednesday. If you come to the jam session, you know, stay through the 6 to 7 p.m. opening set. I'm not sure who that is yet, but I'm sure it'll be great. And then shortly after 7, the jam session kicks off. And this past week, we started right off with Woody and You, the tune we learned last week. So if you show up to the next jam, we can all together play this tune, A Weaver of Dreams, that we're going to learn this week. Just real quickly, let me say thanks to some of the folks, in addition to Bob DeBoo. Thanks, Bob, for your help with everything. Also want to say thanks to some folks here at Jazz St. Louis, Paul Henrich and Patrick Skinner in the production side for hooking up mics and running sound for us and making me sound good. And thanks to Andy Ament and Gabe Miller for their help in producing this whole thing. So if you have questions at any point during the webinar today, you can either drop them in the chat or there will be a Q&A at the very end. So if you've got questions, please don't hesitate to drop those in there. As I mentioned, we're going to do a Victor Young tune called A Weaver of Dreams. And part of the purpose for this webinar is to introduce some songs that you could call at the jam session that are standard tunes that'll adapt really well to that jam session setting, but are maybe tunes that are slightly outside what normally gets called. So if you go to the jam session, you know, you probably would be likely to hear All the Things You Are, or Stella by Starlight, or any number of rhythm changes, rhythmening, or any number of blues melodies. So we're gonna try and introduce some new repertoire for you, and hopefully some new tunes that you'll enjoy playing. And we're gonna try and dig a little bit deeper with these webinars into the history of the tune. Maybe understand a little bit, and
this week we're going to talk a little bit about the composer, and you know, kind of how this tune came to be. And then there's also the communal aspect of this. Jam session is always a great time to get together and celebrate this music, but also to just have the camaraderie of playing music together and making music together. And so this is an effort to get everybody learning some new tunes together and coming together on stage to play them. So without further ado, let's get into A Weaver of Dreams. So let me start by talking just a little bit about Victor Young. He was a composer. He wrote a lot for Hollywood. He was born in, I think, 1899 and lived about 57 years. So he died in the 1950s. And he wrote a bunch of great standard tunes. I Don't Stand a Ghost of a Chance, a great ballad. Stella by Starlight, again, one that frequently gets called at jam sessions. This is another one of his tunes. The very first recording of this tune was actually a Nat King Cole recording. And he recorded it in September of 1951, but it wasn't released until December of that year. So even though he was the first to record it, the first released recording actually came from Bing Crosby. And Bing and Victor Young actually collaborated quite a bit. As I mentioned, Victor made his name writing for movies and for orchestras in Hollywood. And so this was one of many collaborations that they did together. We're going to listen to this first release of the recording. This is Bing Crosby with the John Scott Trotter Orchestra, released in November of 1951. And this is a really cool arrangement. If you're at all familiar with this tune, listen to some of the things that are going on with the orchestration, and there's some little harmonic twists and turns that are a little different than what you might see on the lead sheet. So let's listen to Bing Crosby.
So here's a new song by Victor Young. You know Victor Young that wrote Sweet Sue and My Foolish Heart and Pearls on Velvet and Stella by Starlight, the lyrics by Jack Elliott.
You're a weaver of dreams, you and your strange fascination. You're a weaver of dreams, you and your come-hither smile. Just to hear you speak can leave me weak as a babe in arms. Poor little babe in arms, helpless before your charms. For you're a weaver of dreams, you and your lips warm and tender. Just like magic it seems, thrilling, enchanting me too. I'm in your spell and there's no cure. I'm lost for sure, 'cause you're a weaver of dreams and I'm in love with you. Just like magic it seems, thrilling, enchanting me too. I'm in your spell and there's no cure. I'm lost for sure, 'cause you're a weaver of dreams and I'm in love with you.
So I misspoke. That's actually, it's a recording from January of 1952. So again, the initial recording, the first released recording from November, I can't find. But I'm it's the same orchestra. It's likely the very same arrangement. I know that there are several of Bing Crosby's recordings from the 50s that the originals are lost. And so this may be one of those cases, I'm not sure, but that's from a January broadcast. Bing had a radio show and later a TV show in the 50s, and so that comes from a January broadcast. You hear the talking at the beginning, and he's kind of talking up his buddy composer, Victor Young. So a couple just brief notes about that. You'll notice that if you sit down at the piano and find the key of that one, it's in the key of F. I'm just gonna, if you're keeping score, maybe write down. This one's an F. We're gonna see a couple different keys. And obviously when you're working with a vocalist, like a Bing Crosby, you're gonna put it in whatever register is gonna sound best for that vocalist. Which maybe brings another challenge that we should issue. If there are any vocalists out there that are, you know, maybe thinking of coming to the jam session, learn this tune. You know, this would be a great one to come and sing with some instrumentalists on the jam session. So moving on to one of the next really important recordings of this tune. This one is the album, I guess, is probably best known as Cannonball Adderley Quintet in Chicago. The first copy of this album that I had, the album was titled Cannonball and Coltrane, whichever title, it's the same album. It's Cannonball Adderley with John Coltrane, the rhythm section, Wynton Kelly, Paul Chambers, and Jimmy Cobb. If you're familiar with the album Kind of Blue, then those are familiar names. It's essentially Miles' band from Kind of Blue minus Miles Davis, and also minus Bill Evans, who of course plays piano on much of Kind of Blue. This recording on that record, both Cannonball and Coltrane get a ballad feature with just that saxophonist and the rhythm section. So this is Coltrane's ballad feature, and here they're playing in E flat major. So we were in F on the previous recording, now we're down a whole step. Let's check out John Coltrane playing on Your Weaver of Dreams. To cut, I thought it feels bad to cut John Coltrane off, but I have the power to do it. I should also mention, I know that there were in some of the previously recorded webinars when they've been published to Facebook, maybe there have been bits of audio redacted for copyright. So I'll try and mention specific titles as much as possible if you want to look these recordings up. On YouTube or on Apple Music, We may also be able to drop YouTube links in beneath the webinar in the description so that you can look up those examples and listen along as you would like to. There are a lot of great recordings of this tune. We skipped over the Nat King Cole, which, as I mentioned, okay, Andy says we're going to put a Spotify playlist together with all these recordings, so look for that. A lot of great recordings of this tune. We did not get into the Nat King Cole version again. That was the very first recording, but it was the second one that was released. You notice the difference between the two that we heard. We heard the Bing Crosby's got kind of a Latin, kind of an up feel, rhythmic feel beneath the melody, whereas Coltrane is really treating it as a straightforward ballad. And I think that's maybe a more common treatment of the tune, which raises a question. We're learning these tunes for a jam session. Why are we learning a ballad? Why would we learn a ballad for a jam session? And my justification for that partly is that as an audience member, if every tune that I hear at the jam session, and when we get together to jam, we're, you know, getting together to make music together and to, I don't know, maybe show off things you're working on, but not everything has to be medium to up tempo. And so as an audience member, it's nice to have that palate cleanse of a ballad. And also I'll add that if a ballad gets called at a jam session, in my brain, I'm instantly thinking, okay, this is a challenge to be disciplined and limit myself in the amount that I'm gonna play, both in terms of the number of notes that I'm gonna play, but also the number of choruses that I'm gonna play. So if there are 10 people standing on stage when a ballad is called at a jam session, then I know that I'm probably not gonna take a full chorus of solo. I might think about playing a half chorus. Or, you know, if it's a vocalist and I'm maybe filling behind the vocalist, then I might not play a solo at all. And so I think ballads are great for jam sessions for precisely that reason, because it's a challenge to think about what's the most musical way to approach playing this tune with the number of musicians that are on stage. Okay, so I'll get down off my soapbox for a moment about jam session etiquette, and let's move on to the great Kenny Burrell. You probably know Kenny Burrell as a great jazz guitar player. He was also a great vocalist. This is probably my favorite vocal recording of Weaver of Dreams. So the example we're going to listen to comes from a 1961 release titled Weaver of Dreams. Kenny liked this tune. He actually recorded it in 1956 on a record called Introducing Kenny Burrell, but he doesn't sing on that one. So I want you to hear the vocal recording of Kenny Burrell. This was released on Columbia in November 1961. Here we go.
You're a weaver of dreams, you and your strange fascination. You're a weaver of dreams, you and your come hither smile. Just to hear you speak can leave me weak as a babe in arms. Poor little babe in arms, helpless before your charms. You're a weaver of dreams, you and your lips warm and tender. just like magic, it seems.
Right. So I'll let you spend more time listening to that on your own. But just a beautiful, he's got a beautiful sound. His delivery of the lyric is great. Which, again, even if, whether you're going to sing the tune or you're going to play the tune, I think it's great to take the time, even if you're not as a horn player, I'm maybe not necessarily thinking of the lyrics as I'm playing the melody, but I want to have an awareness of the lyrics, and that's going to, it's going to inform the way that I play the melody. I think if you were to read along with these lyrics and listen to John Coltrane's recording, you know, which is an instrumental recording, or the Freddie Hubbard recording that we're going to listen to in just a moment, the lyric might not match up perfectly with like every note that that the horn player plays as he's playing that melody. But you're going to get a sense of the character of the lyric as you listen. So again, here the lyric is, "You're a weaver of dreams, you and your strange fascination. You're a weaver of dreams, you and your come hither smile." Okay. "Just to hear you speak can leave me weak as a babe in arms. Poor little babe in arms, helpless before your charms." So what's it about? It's a love song, right? It's a love song. There's so many, again, great kind of ballad interpretations of this song that have that characteristic. Okay, one last recording that I want to check out, and we may have Andy find a spot in this one. We're going to listen to Freddie Hubbard, and this is a 1962 recording on Blue Note Records. Notably, this one is in the key of C. We're going to pull up a lead sheet for this tune in just a moment, and you'll notice the lead sheet is in the key of C. If you pull up the chord changes on whatever your preferred play-along app might be, iReal Pro, for example, you'll notice the default key for the tune is probably C. I think that's right. Again, a lot of the examples that we're looking at are not in C. They're either in F or E flat. You know, for me, one of the touchstone recordings is that Coltrane recording, which is in E flat. So why is C the default key? Whoever input the changes decided that was what it is. So that, you know, bear in mind that the default key in iReal Pro is not written in stone. So maybe as you learn this tune, learn it with the thought that I might also need to play this in F or E flat or G. So let's hear Freddie Hubbard. This is from the album Ready for Freddie. That for a moment. This is a really beautiful interpretation. Definitely one to check out and spend a little bit of time with. One of the features of this recording that's cool, obviously really slow ballad tempo for the presentation of the melody, but when they get into the solos, they go into a double time feel. So I'll have Andy skip ahead and see if we can nail at least part of that double time feel. We're almost there. Yeah, that'll work. Mm-hmm. So you hopefully get an idea of that. And that's another possibility for a jam session setting. You know, maybe you play the melody once through it as a ballad and then go to the double time feel. But again, it's a long form. So if I'm in that setting, in a jam session setting and that tune gets called, I'm still going to have to think about limiting the length of my solo so that it doesn't drag on too long. Okay, so I always like to start with listening. Anytime I'm going to learn a tune, I'm going to start by finding what are the quintessential examples, the quintessential recordings of the tune, and I'm going to really try and familiarize myself with those. In this case, you know, we're learning a tune in the style of a Tin Pan Alley tune, meaning it's a song with lyrics. So I want to learn the lyrics. I want to hear as many great examples of that tune as I can and familiarize myself with those, and then dig into the melody. So I'm going to have Andy throw up a lead sheet here, and we'll just kind of get a sense of the form of the tune. So this is a 32 bar A prime form, or you could think of it as 32 bars in total length with a first and second ending. We'll see what that first and second ending looks like. But we can split the form into two halves. And you've got the lyrics there too, so you can kind of follow along and see where those lyrics fit in with the melody notes. This long lead sheet layout is a little bit misleading. So I want to show you more or less a distilled version of the form, so you can see what's actually how much new material you have to learn. Because really, most of the second half of the form is a repeat of the first half. So let's see if we can get that. That's the one. All right. So this is that melody written again with in this case written almost as a first and second. Well, it is in fact written as a first and second ending. So the first 16 bars you see in the first four systems, and then I've just created a break there for the second ending, so that you can see that it's really only the last six bars of the form that are different between A and A prime. So between the first 16 bars and the second 16 bars, it's only the last six bars that are different melodically. One of the things I love about the melody in this example is, and I'll play a little bit of this, is just the shape. So it's got this descending sixth shape that's repeated throughout. I love that descending sixth, that large intervallic leap is really pretty, and it opens up a lot of room for embellishment as well. So again, you get a lot of bang for your buck out of those first 12 bars of the tune, because you get to play them twice in the melodic form. Okay, so moving on to the harmony. Let's look at the harmony for this tune. And you'll notice, I'm trying to kind of distill the information down to its most basic and really highlight how much mileage you get out of the learning the first half of the form. Only five bars are different between the first 16 and the last 16. So you can see that second ending. Instead of going to A7, we've got a little chromatic 2-5 getting us down to the key of C major. All right. So I always think that it's a good idea, especially with Tin Pan Alley standards, if you're a piano player, if you're a guitar player, then you're practicing the chords here or you're practicing the chords here. But as a horn player, I think it's really valuable to practice thirds and sevens and kind of dig into those voicings. Among other things, it helps me get the sound of the chords in my ear. And it's going to inform the kinds of lines that I want to play. If maybe that's new to you, that's good. I've got some resources here that I hope will help make that easy. So we're going to pull up just the first 8 bars of the tune. And a really simple way of, and forgive me if you're looking at this and you're like, this is way too complex for me. I'm going to try and break it down for you so that it's easy. But a very simple way of getting through a harmonic progression is what we call a root shell voicing. Shout out to our friends at Open Studio. Adam Manis calls it root shell pretty. So if we have the root in the left hand, and then the shell is the third and seven. So on a C major seven, we're talking about E natural and B natural. That's your shell, root down here, shell here, and then the pretty would be if we throw any color tones in there. So if I throw the ninth on top, that's the pretty. But we're just going to deal with thirds and sevens. We're going to kind of keep it simple. So C major seven. The next chord we're going to is a B minor seven flat five. And I can keep, this is third on the bottom, seven on top for C7. I can keep the same position and just slide these two notes down a whole step. And that gives me the third and seven for the B minor. Now I'm going to go to E7. So just as we look at these two notes on the keyboard, D and A, E7, the third and seven, the third is G sharp. Without moving this hand at all, I want to think about, okay, I could move everything up here, but instead I'm gonna be lazy. I'm just gonna move this down a half step. So again, B minor seven to E7. And we can really move through all of these voicings. I'm gonna try and transition from chord to chord with as little movement as possible. So seven is here, three is here. Now going to A minor. Three is here, seven is here. And then we're going to G minor. So we're gonna keep third and seven in the same place. But when we go 2-5, G minor seven to C7, we've got a 7-3 resolution. F, the seven of the G minor seven, resolves down a half step to E. So I'll put up a link to these voice leadings so that you can, to the root shell voicings, so that you can practice through those if you're unfamiliar with that style of voicing. I just think it's a great tool for beginning to hear harmony on timpan alley standards like these. Another thing that I find really helpful, again, I mentioned this tune is one that we would potentially maybe need to be able to play in multiple keys. And let's go back to, we can, Andy, if you can pull up that, that one. If we look at the harmony for this, it can be helpful to kind of think about it not only in the key of C, but maybe think of the chords relative to the tonal center. So in this case, we're in C, but if we were called on to play the tune in E flat, I've got to be able to think about, okay, how is the, as I move through the changes, how does the tonal center relate back to the key of E flat? So one way to think about that is through Roman numeral analysis. That sounds like we're really getting hardcore theory, but I think we can kind of walk it back and maybe think about it in a way that's not too daunting. Let's see. Do we have some participants in the chat that might want to jump in? I'm going to take that as a yes. So again, thinking about this in the key of C major, we're starting on the one, or we're starting in the tonic in the key of C. The next change is B minor 7 flat 5 to E7. That's 2-5, and it's going to A minor. So the first four bars, if we're really just trying to distill the information in the first four bars down to its most basic, we've got one in the key of C, and then that 2-5, that minor 2-5, has taken us to A minor. How does A minor relate to C major? Peanut gallery. Maybe I can get a message in the chat. Maybe somebody can tell me, how does A minor relate to C major? Are they related? Are they relatives? Are they, in fact, the relative minor? Yes, A minor is a relative minor. So again, we're starting in a major key, and then a 2-5 to the relative minor key. But instead of going to tonic minor, that's a predominant function. And then moving further through the changes, a 2-5 to the 4. Again, I'm relating everything back to the key we started in. So just taking that much of the tune, we can describe it very simply. Two bars of one chord, and then a bar each, 2-5 to the relative minor. We play the relative minor as a minor 7, and then 2-5 to the 4. Resolves to 4. So if I think about the harmonic progression in that way, then it becomes a lot easier to think about transposing it to other keys. If, for example, I wanted to play the tune in, Coltrane plays it in E flat. So I'm going to start, E flat is the one. So now I've got to think about, okay, I've got a 2-5 going to the relative minor, right? That's what we said. We play two bars of the one chord, and then a 2-5 going to the relative minor. Well, what's the relative minor of E flat major? So we're looking for a minor key that's got the same key signature. Key signature for E flat is 3 flats, I believe. Is that right? That is right. Okay. How did I get tasked with teaching this? So 3 flats, that's key of C minor. Here's our one chord. Now we go 2-5. That C that we're resolving to is a minor 7. And then we got to, from there, go 2-5 to the 4. Okay, so the 4 chord is A flat. Okay. So 2-5 A flat. So if I can think about the chord changes in that way, it becomes a lot easier to remember. And bear in mind also that because of the way this form is structured, that little section that we learned, I think we learned maybe the first 6 bars of the first 16, it all repeats itself. So we've got 12 of the 32 bars in hand now, and essentially to where we could transpose it if we wanted to play this in F sharp. Challenge myself. Yeah, there we go. Cool. I could do it. It might take me a little minute to think through, but by realizing, okay, I'm starting the key of 1, minor 2-5 going to the relative minor key, major 2-5 going to the key of 4. That makes it a lot easier to remember the changes. And then also, I think that when I personally, I feel like if I know a tune in that way, if I can think, okay, starts on the one, and then it goes to this key center, relative minor, it goes to this key center of the four relative to where we started. It just makes it a lot easier to kind of pull that tune up in my memory. So I like that strategy. I do recommend when you're first learning a tune, learn it really well in one key. Because I've definitely found myself falling into the trap sometimes of, okay, I got to learn this tune and be able to transpose it in 12 keys. And then I kind of find myself not really knowing it in any keys. So for me, I learned this tune first in the key of E flat. I'm a tenor saxophone player. That John Coltrane recording is great. It's in E flat. So that's where I learned it. But a lot of the time, you know, if it gets called on a gig, folks want to play it in C because that's the key it's in iReal Pro. So I have to be able to transpose it to other keys. All right. I guess now let's see if there are any questions. Oh yeah, good one. Okay. So the question is, I talked about playing half choruses at the jam session. Oh, I can't read it because he just took it away. You talked about playing half choruses at the jam session on a ballad. How would you communicate that to others while playing? And that's a really great question. Sometimes the most straightforward way is maybe even before we start the tune, if my counterpart Gabe is on stage and we're getting ready to count off the tune, I might say, we might first talk about how we're going to play the melody. Gabe's a trombone player, so I might say, hey, I'm going to sit out. You take the first half of the melody. I'll take the second half of the melody, and I'm only going to play a half chorus of solo. So I think sometimes the simplest way is to communicate it ahead of time. But again, back to the example that I mentioned initially, if there are 10 people on stage, it might not be practical to turn to them, to each one of them individually, and say, hey, I'm only going to play a half chorus. If you're, let's say, taking that first solo after the melody is played, I first want to communicate musically. I want to be sure that I'm communicating musically that my solo arc is sort of coming to an end. And there are a lot of different ways to do that. You know, it could be that you know, get less busy in what you play as you near the halfway point in the form. You can also visually communicate it. You know, if it's a situation where I'm playing on mic and, okay, we're approaching the midway point through the form, and I'm just going to, you know, look to the person to my right or to my left, and you kind of indicate to them, hey, okay, it's your turn to take over here. I think that's a great question. And I always want to be thinking about how to communicate that stuff clearly. Generally, if the first soloist plays the half chorus, if other folks are paying attention, they'll kind of follow suit. So if I'm that first soloist, I might think about communicating that verbally ahead of time, or just being very demonstrative that, okay, now I'm ending my solo, next person take it. Other questions? As a non-pianist, how should I start learning shell voicings? Another great question. There's a fantastic, well, there are a couple great resources. I mentioned Open Studio. Our friends at Open Studio do a lot of really great content. A lot of it's free. So I would encourage you to seek out some of that stuff. There's also, you can pay for stuff, bunch of wonderful resources there, from beginner through super advanced. So that stuff is mostly aimed at piano players, but again, some of it's beginning level piano. There are also a number of really great books out there. There's a Mark Levine book titled something like Jazz Piano, and that goes through, I think, in the first chapter or two, it goes through these root shell voicings, and it's very clear in kind of how to get through those. You can also seek out, you know, if you're here in the St. Louis area, I always recommend seeking out a professional or even semi-professional and see if they'll answer your questions, or better yet, see if you can pay for a lesson. I think it's a great to take opportunity to connect with other musicians. And if I'm a horn player and I'm trying to learn about voicings, I'm not shy about asking or even asking, hey, I'd love to learn more about the way that you voice those chords. Can I meet up with you for a lesson sometime? And you might have to shell out some money for that, but that's a good thing too, because that's supporting other musicians in the scene. Any other resources? Am I missing any? I'm asking our local peanut gallery here. I don't think so. Other questions? If you're playing a solo or starting a solo, and you want to go into double time, how would you communicate that? So I think what the question is asking is kind of referring back to that Freddie Hubbard recording where the melody is at a ballad tempo, but then the rhythm section goes to a double time feel. And a great way of indicating that, in that recording, it's part of the arrangement. But I think also you could simply start playing double time licks. You can just subdivide the beat, and if the rhythm section is paying attention and listening, which of course they are, they're gonna likely go with you to that double time feel. So where does that come from? If you're thinking, okay, I want to do that, but I don't have a lot of double time vocabulary, I would seek out recordings of folks playing ballads where they go to a double time feel. That Freddie Hubbard recording is fantastic, but there are lots of examples out there if you want to seek out other recordings, other tunes where the soloist goes to a double time feel in the solo section. Charlie Parker is another one. So many great recordings with Charlie Parker where he's playing double time over either with the rhythm section going with him or not. I'm thinking of the Bird with Strings recordings where some of those tempos are pretty slow and he's just ripping double time lines over top that. Any other questions? Doesn't look like it. Okay. Well, I want to thank everybody for listening today, for joining us. If you're catching this after the fact, sorry we missed you, but thanks for checking out the webinar after the fact. Look for that Spotify playlist. We may add in a couple of additional recordings in addition to those that we listened to and talked about today. And please join us at the jam session on Wednesday. If you're not in the St. Louis area, find a jam session, or if there's not a local jam session happening, start one. And it doesn't have to be at a public venue. Maybe start a jam session with other musicians in your neighborhood or in maybe in neighboring towns. Get together and play music together. All right. We will see you next week. Welcome, everybody. I hope that you are staying dry. I did not stay dry. I still have water, raindrops on my shoulders. It's crazy out there in St. Louis. So if you're in the area, stay safe, stay dry to the best of your ability. We are going to learn a quick tune in the last installment of this webinar series on learning tunes. And yeah, we'll be quick, and I hope you will enjoy this one. My name is Bennett Wood. I'm the education coordinator here at Jazz St. Louis. A lot of what I do is working with the outfacing school programs that we offer here through Jazz St. Louis. But also, I'm fortunate to have the opportunity to work on this webinar series with you. This is the fourth and final installment of this summer series. If you want to go back and view any of the previous webinar series, you can find those on the Jazz St. Louis Education Facebook page. So definitely check that out. Also, I want to say thanks to our friends at the Dark Room, and in particular to Bob DeBoo, who's been leading the Wednesday night jazz jam session at the Dark Room. I guess previously it was at the Kranzberg Arts Foundation, now at the Dark Room, for several years now. He's been leading that. He always does a great job. If you are in the St. Louis area and you have not come down to that jam session, if you have interest in playing jazz, you know, please come down. Bob always does a great job of welcoming newcomers and including everybody that comes down to play. So thank you to him. Also, I want to thank the folks here at Jazz St. Louis that have helped make this possible. First and foremost, my colleagues in education here, Andy Ament and Gabe Mueller. And I said, I did it. Miller. It's spelled like Mueller, but it's Miller. Gabe Miller. and then also from production, I'll say thanks to our friends there, in particular to Paul Henrick, who hooked us up with microphones, and Ryan, what's your last name?
Vogel.
Ryan Vogel, who's running sound for us today. So thanks to all those folks. So this webinar series, again, this is the last installment, but if you're new to it, the purpose of this series is to kind of introduce some new repertoire, maybe some things that don't get called as regularly at the jazz jam session here, or you know, maybe if you're in a different city, maybe this will introduce some stuff that you haven't played at the jazz jam, but tunes that I think are very accessible and adapt well to that situation. We're also going to be digging into a little bit of the historical and cultural context of the tunes. And hopefully, as we learn new repertoire together, it can bring us together as a community. And if nothing else, bring us together on stage and share in some new music. Finally, we'll talk about some ways that you can retain or expand your knowledge. If I happen to pick a tune that you already know, then you know maybe stick around to the end and hear some of my thoughts for things that you could do to challenge yourself going forward. So the tune this week is Bluesette by the great Toots Thielemans. That's a name that is synonymous with chromatic harmonica, but Toots was talented in a lot of other areas as well. Obviously, this is one of his compositions, but we're gonna hear him play guitar. We're gonna hear him do some whistling. So he was a really incredible musician. He was born in 1922 in Brussels, and he passed away in 2016. He lived to 94 years of age, and actually kept performing all the way until his 90s. So a very long and illustrious career. His first professional performances actually took place with Benny Goodman. Benny Goodman heard him in 1949 and hired him pretty much right away. It was only after he'd hired Toots into the band that he had the realization that he'd never performed professionally before. And so he, you know, that's kind of a cool thing. Most of us, we kind of play our first professional gigs in less high-stakes settings than with Benny Goodman. So he immigrated to the United States in 1951. He became a citizen in 1957. And then from there, started a long career, first of all, with George Shearing. He played with George Shearing for a pretty long stint from 1953 to 1959. And then he worked a lot in Hollywood. The tune we did last week actually was written by... you know, another guy who spent a lot of time writing for Hollywood, but in this case, Toots mostly was featured on soundtracks. So The Pawnbroker, Midnight Cowboy, The Getaway, Express, he played on all of those. And also, his harmonica was featured on the original music for Sesame Street. So if you're familiar with that, I grew up with Sesame Street, so you know that it's a good frame of reference for me anyway. He was a frequent collaborator with Quincy Jones. We'll actually hear one of those examples. And definitely a musician to check out if you haven't already. So let's get on to the tune. Bluesette is one of Toots Thielemann's first, I guess, kind of well-known jazz compositions. He wrote it probably in 1961. The first recording that he made of it is in 1962. And it comes from a record titled simply Toots. So I'm going to have Andy play that for us. We'll listen to a little bit of that 1962 recording. That's such a great recording, and you know, of course, for me, one of the things that stands out is just the timbre of that whistling solo. Well, is it a whistling solo or a guitar solo? He's playing guitar and whistling the notes at the same time, which is just a really cool sound. It has the song has such a kind of bright, happy feel to it. One of the things, and we'll talk about this a little further in. There's a real distinctive intro that we hear with kind of a sharp nine sound. Let's see, they do that one. Yeah, so that's, I think, a nice way to get in and out of the tune, and that kind of crunchy sharp nine sound contrast nicely with the bright kind of happy sound of the rest of the tune. Okay, so there's Toots playing his own tune. Let's check out some other recordings of this by some other folks. The next one we'll listen to is from Jimmy Smith. This is from a record called Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf? Of course, an allusion to the great author. If you have a chance, look for this record, the album cover online, because the album cover is hilarious. It's got Jimmy Smith standing next to somebody in a trench coat with a wolf's mask on. So it's definitely worth seeking out. I should also mention that all of these recordings, I know that we sometimes run into issues where, because of copyright, the audio gets redacted from the video. So we will post a Spotify playlist that's got all these tunes in it. So if you're checking this out after the fact and you're going, where's the audio? You can find that Spotify playlist. So here we go. Let's listen to Jimmy Smith, Who's Afraid, from the album Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. This is, again, the tune Bluesette. After they play the melody, after Jimmy Smith plays the melody there, he makes an allusion to a line that Toots plays in that recording from 1962. So that might be something to revisit also. It's almost a kind of a shout chorus that's a part of the original recording, and I think it's so distinctive and it holds up so well that you hear that featured in a lot of recordings. Of course, he doesn't play the whole shout chorus all the way through, but he at least makes an allusion to it there at the beginning of his solo. Okay, so that's one example of this with pretty heavy arrangement. Gabe's over here digging on the bass trombone on that recording. It's amazing. So from that we go to a Quincy Jones recording from 1975, and this was the first album that Quincy Jones released following he had a brain aneurysm, and so he recovered from that, and then this was the next record that came out, and it definitely has that mid-70s kind of vibe to it, complete with super groovy lyrics and a kind of crazy arrangement. So let's check out Quincy Jones. One last one. I should mention also on that recording, that's we're hearing Toots Thielemans again on whistling and guitar. So that's just one example of a collaboration between he and Quincy Jones. There's another two recordings. One I'll just talk about briefly, and then another that we'll listen to. Part of the reason you may be listening to this going, "Huh, why did you pick this tune?" A part of the reason I think this tune's a great one for a jam session has to do with the meter, or the time signature, if you will. So as you're listening, you know, think about this tune. ¶¶ right? So it's in 3/4 time. A lot of what we play at jam sessions is in 4/4. So just that little bit of difference. Last week with Weaver of Dreams, we were picking a ballad, and I think that it's important to remember your audience, even maybe especially at a jam session. Be thinking about what's going to serve the music best and what's going to serve the audience best, because you would hate for somebody to go out to hear jazz for the first time and they go to a jam session and they're just, everything was the same tempo, everything was the same time signature, everybody just played a bunch of super fast lines, I didn't understand any of it, I don't like jazz. So that's a thing that does happen. As musicians, it's our job to make sure that we're making musical choices that not only engage and excite each other, but also engage and excite our audience members. So I like to think about, okay, what's something that's going to be a little different than the other tunes that get called at the session all the time? Something that's in three is great. I think about some of the kind of standard tunes that get called all blues. Great tune. Gets played a lot. That's another one that you could call if you want to kind of get away from 4/4 for a little bit. Something like Footprints, again, gets called quite a lot. Someday My Prince Will Come. So this is just a little bit off that beaten path of the kind of well-worn standards that get called for the jam session. And again, gets us out of 4/4 a little bit. I mentioned that because in 1992, Toots Thielemans recorded Bluesette yet again on an album called The Brazil Project. And on that recording, they perform it as a bossa nova in 4. So it's a tune that's adaptable to different meters, and I think that's another possibility. We might stick a pin in that for now, but another possibility would be to think about changing up the meter. So one final recording that we'll check out, and then we'll kind of get into the nuts and bolts of the tune. We talk about Toots Thielemans as a great harmonica player, and really he's the quintessential jazz harmonica player. I thought we should at least have one example that is Toots playing harmonica. So this is from a 1985 recording. The album was titled Bluesette. And here's Toots playing chromatic harmonica. Yeah, I think one of the beautiful things about his playing is partly the limitations of the instrument. And he does things that shouldn't be possible on chromatic harmonic. I'm not trying to downplay his virtuosity at all, but the chromatic harmonic is just hard to get around on. It's not like saxophone where I can just blow through the tube and wiggle my fingers. That one's for you, Gabe. I think that those limitations actually kind of affect the way that he approaches improvisation. And what I mean by that is that he has to be a little bit more selective and really focus on playing melodic ideas that have a strong content. So if you're a beginning improviser, or if you're an advanced improviser, I think it's great to take solos from folks like Toots Thielemans, or another of my favorites is J.J. Johnson, because again, like sometimes those simpler ideas, Miles Davis, there's another one, those more straightforward kind of simple ideas can sometimes be the hippest ideas. And so I love his approach to melody, and this is a great tune. So in that treatment, obviously it's a lot different than the 1962 recording that we heard, where it's a much more up-tempo version of the song. In that example, he's definitely treating it more like a ballad. So this, again, Bluesette, it's a tune that has a lot of flexibility. It's definitely one that is good to have in your back pocket for a jazz jam situation, because you know, more than likely, if you get called up to the stage to play, more than likely somebody hasn't just played a waltz, and you can always, you know, have that flexibility of tempo. If you need to call something that's a little more up tempo, then this can be that. Or if you need to play something that's slower to just change it up, then this can be that as well. So I like tunes like that for a jazz jam session, so that I don't end up in the situation where I'm called up to the stage and the inevitable question comes, what tune do you want to play? And then I'm going, I don't know, you know, or I had a tune in mind, but you just played a tune that has very similar changes or has the same tempo. So something like this allows you a little bit more flexibility. So I think it's a great one to learn. All right, with that in mind, let's dive into the tune itself. Andy's going to go ahead and pull up the full lead sheet here so we can just kind of look at the form in its entirety. So we've got a 24-bar form, and it breaks down really nice into 8-bar sections. So I think we'll kind of dig into these individually, but before we do that, let me just play through we've heard the melody a lot, but let me play through it just a little bit and see if I can find the mistakes in there. Artistic license with some of that. Also, if you listen back to some of those recordings, you'll notice that the last 4 bars, sometimes they simply hold out that F concert at the end. But I hear that enough in the recordings, this line 4 from the end, that I figured we might as well include it. It's easy, very easy to just simply hold out the F if you wanna go that way with the melody. So let's dive into some kind of get a little more granular with it and deal with just the first 8 bars of the tune. So as we've talked over the last few weeks, I've made a couple of recommendations for just retaining melodies. And one of the ones that I use all the time, I like to think about tunes relative to the starting pitch, the starting pitch relative to the key. So in this case, we're in the key of B flat. The starting pitch is F. So if you think, okay, B flat, C, D, E flat, F, that's the fifth note within the B flat major scale. So we're starting on the fifth. And that melody just basically runs up the scale to begin with. It's ending, if you're looking at bar three, it's ending on, I'm going to talk chord function here, it's ending on the flat five. So A minor seven, flat five. So that, to me, kind of makes it, at least the beginning part of the melody is real, real easy. You know, we can think of it just as a, what scale is that? Is there anybody in the chat that knows the quality of that scale? If we play a major scale starting on the fifth scale degree, what scale is that? Who do we got? Who can we call out? Oh, there's all kinds of people we can call out. Hayden, what's a B flat major scale but starting on F? Or Jason? Or Hannah? Or Raymond? Somebody jump in the chat. A major scale starting on the fifth scale degree. So if we start on B flat, play a B flat major scale starting on B flat, that's an Ionian scale. If we start on C, we play the same notes, it's a Dorian scale, right? So if we play a B flat major scale but starting on the fifth scale degree, starting on F, that's a Mixolydian scale. So the first part of the melody is just a Mixolydian scale. But when we land on that, it's an F for me, it's an E flat concert. Again, that's the flat five of that chord, of A minor seven, flat five. And then the melody does kind of a cool thing. It goes flat five and then leaps down to the seven. And then we just get a 7-3 resolution. So that shape repeats itself a couple times. Then the next chord, G minor 7, again, we're landing on the 5th, jumping down to the 7, and then a 7-3 resolution. So even though this melody has some pretty large intervallic leaps, you can maybe help yourself. I feel like it helps me to remember what's going on and maybe internalize those leaps if I think about what's happening, relating the melody to the harmony as it goes by. So let's kind of talk through that real quickly before we move on to the next section. So the first two bars, very straightforward, just B flat major 7. So we're in the key of B flat. That's a one chord. Then we've got a 2-5 in G minor. So, you know, you can think like, yeah, 2-5 of the relative minor, right? Yeah, check my math. So, and then we're just moving down 2-5s by whole step. So G minor and then 2-5 in F and then 2-5 in E flat. So again, thinking about it in that way allows me a little bit, allows me the ability to generalize over those two bar sections if I want to. Now, if you want to get really specific with the chords, you can do that too. But at least initially when I'm learning a tune, I find it helpful to think, okay, I start in the key and then I'm going to the relative minor and then down by whole steps. Okay, let's move on from there to bars 8 through 15. Okay, so just thinking back through what we just saw, B flat. We'll just kind of think through it together. We started in B flat, and then we 2-5 in G. So A minor 7 flat 5 to D 7, G minor 7 to C 7, F minor 7 to B flat 7, and then we go to E flat major 7. So that was that 2-5 to E flat resolves, right? So in measure 9, we're landing on E flat and we're hanging out there for full two bars. Then we get the same, we're really continuing the same motion, again, down in whole steps, but the harmonic rhythm has slowed down a little bit. So where we were moving down by whole step every two bars, now we're hanging out in the key of E flat for a full two bars, and E flat minor 7 to A flat 7 to D flat 7, that's all the key of D flat, right? E flat minor 7 is the 2, A flat 7 is the 5, D flat major 7, that's the 1. So we get four bars hanging out in the key of the people's key of D flat major 7, everyone's favorite key to play in. And then we're going to continue the motion down another whole step from there. So D flat minor 7 to G flat 7, and then finally going to resolve to C flat major 7, ugh, or B, however you want to think of it. You know, as a saxophone player, I like sharp keys, but I wrote it in C flat major 7 because I know that some pianists like those flats. So finally, we're going to break the chain of whole step resolutions. After we land on C flat, then we get 2-5 going to the key of B. Well, it's really a 2-5 in B flat minor, but it's going to take us back to B flat. So we've got C. It's a really small print from here, but C minor 7 flat 5 to F 7, and then a D minor 7, so this is kind of a 3-6 thing, but we've got a tritone sub in there. In the last four bars, you have the 3, so D minor 7, that tritone sub in the D flat 7, and then a 2-5 taking us back to the top of the form. So I've kind of talked through the harmony. I guess I got away from the melody a little bit, but let's go back to looking at the whole tune in its entirety. One of the things that I think is kind of cool about this tune, and it's in large part because of that pattern of descending, we're descending 2-5s by whole step, is that it's, first of all, it's a progression that we see all the time. So descending by whole steps, you see that on the Bridge to Cherokee, you see that on bird blues, so something like Chi-Chi or Blues for Alice or a tune like Confirmation. We see that you know, moving down by whole steps, and there are you know, probably 100 other tunes that don't immediately come to mind that have that descending by whole step pattern to them. But one of the things that I think is important about that, you know, again, for this tune, we're playing a familiar progression, but because it's in three, the idea is that, you know, that you maybe typically play on a bird blues, suddenly those don't line up exactly right. So you have to kind of learn to adapt your vocabulary to the changes, or rather to the rhythm of the changes. Because it's moving with a one less beat per measure than what you had in a bird blues in four. So let's move now and talk a little bit about the harmony. And one of the things, if you've, you know, viewed the other three of the webinar series, you know that I like to talk about 7-3 leading tones. I think that's such an important part of understanding jazz harmony, and especially, you know, when we're dealing with 2-5s and 2-5-1, it's essential to be familiar with that movement, that 7-3 resolution, to be able to play lines that are gonna resolve and that are going to clearly follow the harmony. So let's dig into that. Again, we'll kind of go 8-bar section by 8-bar section. Here's the first 8 bars. And what you see here, we're in treble clef. I don't know if we have trombone players or bass players in here. I'm sorry. I put it in treble clef because that's what felt comfortable. So blame it on me being a saxophonist. One moment. Let me grab this stand real quickly. Yeah, that'll go in the outtakes. Perfect. All right. So I have to get rid of that because let's just take a look at how these chords resolve. I got to remind myself where I started. Can you go back to the harmony there, Andy? Okay. Cool. So I did put... we started in this position with the third on the bottom and the seven on top. So again, this is just a basic root. So we got B flat in the root and then a shell voicing, third and seven here. So then in bars 3 and 4, I shift it up. I'll move it down here. So this is the seven, A minor seven, flat five. And the third here. And just continuing that movement down. So it finally, in bar 9, resolves to an E flat. But let's just go through that again slowly so that you can. So here's starting with the 7 on the bottom. We could flip that voicing too. So I started here. We could flip it here. And then if we go this way, we're putting the third on the bottom and the seven on top. So what I'd like you to pay attention is just watching. Pay attention to this. That's that 7 to 3. Dee da, dee da, dee da, da. Right, and then in bar 9, we'll kind of continue through this progression. We hang out on E flat. Again, the harmonic rhythm slows down here. Now we're going to the key of D flat via 2-5. Hangs out on D flat for a couple bars, and then still continuing that harmonic motion down to C flat major 7. Hang out on C flat major 7 for a little bit. This is where the pattern finally breaks. We finally go away from resolving down by whole step. We get the C minor 7 flat 5 going to F7. With some juicy alterations. And then finally to 3-6. But instead of a 2-5 here, we're getting a tritone. Now 2-5 finally back to B flat. So if you wanted, you could even, we don't even have to play the full shell. You could just do a single note, starting on the 7. So this is back to the very beginning of the
recording in progress.
Recording in progress, great. Back to the very beginning of the form. We've got a B flat major 7 starting on, I'm just playing the A. Here's bar 9. And then we just continue that same shape. So that whole thing, we just kind of, it's just chromatic 7-3 resolution all the way down. So, you know, anytime I see chords resolving down by 2-5, resolving down by whole step like that, I'm looking for lines that will kind of follow that 7-3 resolution. If I can make my lines catch some of those 7-3 resolutions, you can hear the harmony of the tune, even without a rhythm section. And as a horn player, that's always what I want to get with learning a tune. I want to be so comfortable with it that even if the rhythm section like completely dropped out, I would still feel comfortable with the harmony and feel comfortable with the time. So I think that really mastering those 7-3 resolutions is a great way to do that. A great way to practice hearing the harmony and then start building lines that follow that to help make it clear. Okay, so any questions from the, we had a very vocal group, lots of interaction about the Mixolydian question. So, but I'll throw it out there. Do we have any questions about 7-3 resolutions, or is that old hat for you? Is that something that you've already mastered and you're tired of it? Apparently, okay, good. All right, so if you're, you know, if you're not already a keyboard player, I definitely recommend, and this is for guitar players too, because, you know, guitar, yeah, you're playing the chords, but I guess the difference is, for me, forgive me, I'm a pea brain, you know, saxophonist, so I only deal with one note at a time. But guitar is so much more complicated. It's not as clearly laid out as the piano. And so it's very easy on piano for me to look and say, okay, yeah, this is... I can watch that that resolution, and you can have the visual connection in addition to the aural connection. So I think that's really helpful. I recommend everybody, you know, spend a little bit of time, at least learning root and shell voicings for tunes like this. So let's say that we've mastered the melody and you've learned the changes. You kind of gotten around how to play some ideas that work in 3. There's still always the consideration that I want to bear in mind when I'm learning tunes, which is how do I begin the tune and how do I end the tune? And I feel like the challenges are maybe not as clear cut for a tune like this. And I don't know if it's not entirely the fact that it's in 3-4. But that might be one of the reasons that it can be a little bit more challenging to figure out how to end it. So let's go back to one of our examples, one of our recorded examples real quickly. We're going to listen to that 1962 recording of Toots Thielemans. Let's listen to the very beginning of the tune, and then we'll check out the end as well. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, so it's got this really cool organ sound happening. Yeah, okay. I'm not a piano player, but I can fake it part of the time. So I definitely would encourage, you know, rhythm section folks to check that out. And I'll go ahead and have Andy throw up just kind of a transcribed version of what's going on here. So in the right hand, you know, you've got the piano voicing. This is sharp nine. So third and seven. This is a B flat sharp nine. I didn't write it in the chord change, but that's what it is. And so the right hand here, what's written in the treble clef, is just this voicing taken up a half step. And then you can see also what the bass plays. So together, see if I can do this. Yeah, something like that. But it's pretty simple intro, but I think it's a really nice contrast. I mentioned this when we listened to this initially. I think it's a nice contrast with the kind of happy, upbeat feel of the rest of the tune, because it's got that crunchy, kind of gritty element. So that's how they start the tune. Let's hear the ending of that 1962 recording. Here's the melody going out. Yeah, cool. So that's definitely one way to do it. If you survey some of the other examples that we listened to and check out the endings of the tunes, a lot of them use that same riff that we just listened to, and then simply do a studio fade. That is maybe not a realistic option for the jazz jam, but you know, you can do an artificial studio fade, just everybody keep playing quieter and quieter. But I also like the way that Toots ends that recording, where clearly he just kind of gave him a look and bump, 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 and that works. But it might be the kind of thing that you want to discuss ahead of counting off the tune. Hey, we're gonna go back to the intro and we're just gonna hang out there and kind of studio fade. That's a perfectly fine way to convey what's supposed to happen at the end of the tune, and if you're dealing with, you know, I think even moderately experienced rhythm section players, and you tell them, yeah, we're gonna go back to the vamp and then just kind of fade it out, they're gonna be able to hang with that no problem. So always think about how you're gonna begin or end the tune. I think that too often, I'm speaking from experience, too often I learn the melody, I learn the changes, I feel, you know, get to where I feel comfortable playing over the tune, and then I get into the jam session setting and we start the tune and I play my solo, and then I'm sitting there thinking, how are we gonna end this? You know, so don't be like me. Don't find yourself in that situation. Think about it ahead of time. Do the research and figure out a good way to end the tune before you are on stage trying to do that. That's my recommendation. Okay, so we've got beginnings and endings. We've talked about the harmony. We've talked about the melody. Let's say that you've mastered this tune already and you're kind of looking for next steps. You know, one option is to, I picked this tune out partly because it's a different time signature, but another option might be to change up the time signature again. So I mentioned the Brazil Project recording by Toots Thielemans, where they play it in 4/4 as a bossa. If you're used to playing it in 3, then 4/4 might be a real challenge. Another option would be maybe to play it in 5. If you want to dabble in some odd time signatures, that might be a good option as well. So I think that's a good way to kind of maybe break it up or think outside the box. Any other questions? Are there ways that I approach transitioning licks and ideas from 4/4 to 3/4? Or do you have to find language in 3? That's a really good question. Confession time. I also picked this tune because I feel like I don't play that well in 3. And so I'm always looking for more, you know, when I find something like that where I feel like, okay, this is a definite weakness, I'm looking for opportunities to work on it. So for me, it's definitely, I feel like playing in 3 is still a work in progress because I just don't play in 3 as much as I play in 4, so I don't feel as comfortable. I don't have as much vocabulary. But the most straightforward way to deal with it is simply to prioritize. And that's what I'm doing is I'm trying to prioritize playing in that meter to where I will get more comfortable. I think, you know, it does sometimes help to think through ideas that you would play in 4 and then maybe think about some ways that you can adapt them to make, you know, make it work out. So we could take a simple 2-5 idea. So, you know, that's starting on 1 and resolving on 1 of the next measure. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. So if I'm thinking in 3, let's just kind of contextualize that. So I'm playing 2-5 in the key of B flat. So I'm going to be thinking 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. So I might even think, you know, another reason I really recommend for folks that they, especially for horn players, that you sit down at the piano, I find it really helpful to sing my ideas. And so, again, that's the original idea that we started with. And so I want to keep that part of the shape in there. De-da-de-da. Oh, whoops. De-da-de-da-da-da-da-da. Or I might think 1, 2, 3. So sometimes, you know, just maybe putting on a metronome and playing through changes, singing ideas in 3, that can kind of help your brain to start working around, okay, how can I make these some of the basic characteristics of this idea work in a different meter. And then I just think playing tunes in 3 really helps. Transcription is always great. And I'm mentioning that, you know, kind of towards the end of this discussion of adapting stuff to 3/4. But I think that's, you know, again, in trying to address some of my own weaknesses in playing in 3, I feel like transcription is probably the best way, in particular because I don't simply want to adapt ideas from 4/4 to 3/4 time. I feel like you may be kind of missing out on the opportunity to play some things that are a little bit more rhythmically interesting by simply saying, oh, I'm going to take something from 4 and adapt it. Well, you know, it may be that whoever your favorite tenor player, piano player, drummer, that they have already come up with vocabulary that in 3 is going to be hipper and more interesting than simply taking something from 4/4 and adapting it. All right. Other questions. Good tunes or specific recordings to learn language in three. Well, I would say Bluesette by Toots Thielemans is a great one because it's chock full of 2/5s. So again, if you're looking for 2/5 vocabulary, that's it right there. You know, again, another one for me, and this is really something that I'm kind of trying to prioritize in my own playing. A tune that got called at the jam session last night, Contemplation, which is kind of a slow minor tune, McCoy Tyner thing. I think they play it quite a bit slower than that, even on the real McCoy. So that recording for me, Joe Henderson, one of my favorite tenor players, and McCoy Tyner, one of my favorite musicians on any instrument, on piano. I'm going to listen to those guys and see what they're doing in that field to make it swing, to make it sound good. Part of the fun of learning to play this music is finding the recordings that speak to you. So, I mean, those are the ones that speak to me specifically, but I would encourage each of you to, you know, spend some time and seek out some tunes. You know, I mentioned a couple that you know are in three. All Blues, Someday My Prince Will Come, Alice in Wonderland. There's a great recording of that tune from Bill Evans live at the Village Vanguard. There are so many tunes in three, but I would encourage you to seek out some of your favorite musicians and find tunes that they recorded in three and steal some ideas. All right, I think that's our time. So thanks for everybody for sticking around. Again, stay dry, stay safe out there. The streets were crazy about an hour ago, so it's been a kind of wild weather week here in St. Louis. So hope everybody's staying safe. And reminder again, the tune we learned today, Bluesette, will be played at the jam session this coming Wednesday. I don't have that date on the calendar. The 3rd of August. So please come out to the Dark Room here in Grandelle Square on the 3rd of August. The jam session happens from 6 to 9. There's an opening set. And then everybody's welcome to come up between 7 and 9. So hope to see you there.